Shiva Yeah, sure. Hare 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 Thank you. प्रेमानंदे जय श्री नित्य गौर प्रेमानंदे जय श्री नित्य गौर प्रेमानंदे श्री गुरुदेव की श्री प्रभुपाद की श्री भक्ति प्रज्ञान देशम गोस्वामी महाराज की श्री रूप अनुग गुरुमार्ग की Srila Gurudev's Transcendental New Zealand Festival 2008 Kida Salve the Bhakta Vrinda Kida Sai Gaura Primanande
Hi. अज्ञानतिमिरान्धस्य ज्ञानञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। वंशाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। नमो महाबदन्नाय कृष्ण प्रेम प्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्य नाम्ने गौरतिशे नमः। गुरवे गौरचन्द्राय राधिकायै तदालये कृष्णाय कृष्णभक्ताय तदभक्ताय नमो नमः। तवैवास्मि न जीवामि स्वया विना इति विज्ञाय राधे तन्नय माम चरणं। प्रारंभ में मैं अपने परमाराध्यतम नित्य लीला प्रविष्ट हूँ विष्णुपाद श्री श्रीमद भक्ति प्रज्ञान केशव गोस्वामी महाराज जी के चरण कमलों में अपनी श्रद्धा दंडवत प्रणति पुष्पांजलि करता हूँ, अर्पित करता हूँ। तत्पश्चात अपने शिक्षा गुरु नित्य लीला प्रविष्ट हूँ विष्णुपाद श्री श्रीमद भक्ति प्रज्ञान केशव गोस्वामी महाराज भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी महाराज जी के भी चरणों में हम अपने श्रद्धा पुष्पांजलि अर्पित करता हूं। तुलसी कहा ये ठीक है, किंतु ये पात्र ऐसा क्यों लाते हैं? बहुत छोटा पतला है। जय जय राधा कृष्ण जुगल मिलन। ओ जय जय राधा कृष्ण जुगल मिलन। Thank you. तो कल हम लोगों ने श्रीमद् भागवत से बतलाया ब्रह्मा और शंकर के समान ज्ञानी होने पर भी बिना गुरु के ज्ञान नहीं होता। बिनु गुरु भवन भी तरे न कोई, जो बिरंच शंकर सम होई, नहीं हो सकता। इसलिए गुरु की जरूरत है। किंतु जो लोग हमारे हृदय के अज्ञान को दूर नहीं कर सकते, जो लोग भगवान से हमारा संबंध नहीं करा सकते, जो विषयों में अनासक्त नहीं है, विषयों में ही डूबे हुए हैं, जब भागवत पाठ करते हैं तो रुपये की तरफ में देखते हैं, ऐसे गुरु से नहीं होगा। इसलिए गुरु के लक्षण बतलाए और उसी के उदाहरण में बतलाया कि भगवान के 27 अवतार व्यास जी हैं, वेदों का विभाग कर लिया, ब्रह्म सूत्र की रचना कर दी, महाभारत इत्यादि की रचना की, पुराण उपपुराण शाखा पुराणों की भी रचना की, और अंत में सबका सार लेकर के भागवत की भी रचना नहीं की थी। उस समय उनको आत्मा की प्रसन्नता नहीं हुई और उस समय नारद जी आए और नारद जी ने कहा कि कुशल है तो प्रसन्न हो, तो नहीं गुरु जी मैं तो प्रसन्न नहीं हूं, मैंने सब कुछ किया किंतु अभी तक मेरी आत्मा प्रसन्न नहीं हो सकी। आप वैद्य हैं, आप बतला सकते हैं। तब उन्होंने कहा जिस प्रकार से आपने धर्म अर्थ और काम इसका वर्णन किया है शास्त्रों में, स्वयं भगवान कृष्ण के संबंध में वर्णन नहीं किया, उनकी लीला कथाओं का वर्णन नहीं करने से आप कभी भी प्रसन्न नहीं हो सकते हैं। तब व्यास जी ने कहा कि मैं कैसे जानूंगा, तो देखो भगवत भक्ति की द्वारा समाधि में आओ। मतलब क्या, पहले भगवान के चरणों में आत्मसमर्पण करो और ये सोचो जो मैं कुछ नहीं समझता नहीं जान सकता, आप कृपा करके हमारे हृदय में उस तत्व की स्फूर्ति कराइए, आप स्वयं हमारे हृदय में प्रकट हो, तब ये होगा। तो उन्होंने ऐसा ही किया। तो उसके पहले वेद शास्त्रों का विचार वर्णन करने से पहले गुरु सदगुरु जो होता है अपने जीवन का उदाहरण देकर, मैंने भगवान को कैसे पाया, हमारी भगवान की अनुभूति कैसे हुई, इसके द्वारा अपने शिष्य को बोध दे, ज्ञान दे, जिससे उसको समझ में आ जाए। जैसे हमारे उत्तरकांड में देखते हैं गरुड़ जी को मोह प्राप्त हुआ, ये राम ये भगवान कैसे हो सकते हैं, इनको नागपाश ने जब बांध दिया मेघनाद ने और ये मरही से गए थे और मैं जाने के साथ ही साथ में सब छोड़ करके भाग गए, ये भला राम कैसे,
भगवान कैसे,
कुछ मोह में दुविधा में पड़ गए, शंकर जी के पास में गए, आप प्रयोग करके ये बतलाइए कि वो कौन है, मुझको संदेह हो रहा है कि जो अपने आप सब जिनके पास में लिपट करके बांध दिया और मेरी जाने से छोड़ दिया, तो मेरे से भी बलहीन है। कहा अभी मुझको समय नहीं है, मैं काम पर जा रहा हूं, तुम गरुड़ जी के पास, उसके कालभूषण जी के पास में जाओ, वो तुम्हारा सब बतला देंगे। तो वो पक्षी राज होकर के गरुड़, और पक्षियों में सबसे नीच होता है कौआ, उस कालभूषण जी के पास में गए और उनको प्रणाम किया। अरे आप पक्षी राज हमारे राजा होकर के हमको प्रणाम कर रहे हैं, मैं आपको पहले नहीं समझता था, अब समझा शिव जी की कृपा से, इसलिए आपको मैं सब चरणों में शरणागत हूं, आप हमारा मोह दूर कर दीजिए। तो उन्होंने कालभूषुंडी ने अपना उदाहरण दे करके उनको समझाया किस प्रकार से मुझको भी राम के चरित्र में संदेह हो गया, अयोध्या में गया कौआ जाति, छोटे से राम थुमक थुमक करके नृत्य करते हुए मालपुआ के टुकड़े को कभी उसे दिखलाते और मैं जाकर के लेने की चेष्टा करते और फिर रोने लगते, नहीं ये क्या, ये भगवान कैसे हैं, ये एक रोटी का टुकड़ा भी हमसे, पुए का मालपुए का एक टुकड़ा भी बचा नहीं सकते, वो भगवान कैसे हो सकते हैं। इतने रामचंद्र जी की कृपा हुई हमारे ऊपर में और उनके मुख में प्रवेश किया और सारा विश्व ब्रह्मांड सब कुछ देखा, और करोड़ों वर्ष लग गए। इसके बाद में फिर अयोध्या में वही मालपुआ खा रहे थे, मैं वहां पर उसी अवस्था में मैं पहुंचा और उनको देखा तो वो हंस दिए, फिर उनके मुख से निकल गया ओह हमारा संदेह होगा। इसी प्रकार से मैं तुम्हारा अनुभव बतलाया, संदेह मत करो। तो गुरु अपने शिष्य को अपना भगवान के संबंध में अपना अनुभव बतलाता है और शिष्य को उससे ज्ञान होता है, शास्त्रों से पीछे सदगुरु जरूर अपने अनुभव बतलाएगा, ऐसे ऐसे हमने भगवान को पाया। इस तरह से ये गुरु तत्व की महिमा है, बिना गुरु के ऐसा ज्ञान नहीं हो सकता है। इसके बाद में नारद जी ने कहा सुनो, मैंने भगवान की कैसी अनुभूति की है, मैं तुमको बतलाता हूं, ये कह करके अपना ज्ञान बतलाने लगे।
गुरु कृपा बिना बाबानी नहीं कर था जो करीची ब्रह्म समा। Even if one is as powerful as Brahma or Lord Shiva, without the mercy of the spiritual master, one cannot cross the ocean of birth and death. Therefore, one should not choose a spiritual master who is not detached from material objects. One should not choose a spiritual master who is unable to dispel the doubts in the heart of the disciple. And most of all, one should not choose a spiritual master who cannot establish a relationship with Sri Radha and Krishna. Therefore, we were hearing yesterday how Vyasadeva, he is a Shaktivesh avatar of Bhagawan. That means one special power of the Lord has entered him. Therefore, despite dividing the Veda into four, compiling the Puranas, 48 types of Puranas, Upanishads, despite writing Vedanta Sutra, his soul himself was not satisfied. Therefore, that time his spiritual master came, Sri Narad Muni. Narad Muni asked Vyasadeva, are you happy? He said, no, Gurudev. Naradji asked, why are you not satisfied? You have done so much. He said, Gurudev, I cannot tell my own disease. You please tell me, what is my problem? Why am I not satisfied despite doing so much high endeavor? Then Narad Muni said, you have only described about the goals of materialistic life. Dharma, mundane religiosity, artha, economic development, and calm, religious sense enjoyment. But you have not described anything about the soul and the relationship it has with the super soul, Sri Krishna. You have not described the pastimes of the Lord, therefore you are not satisfied. Then Vyasadeva said, how is it possible for me to understand this? Then Srinarayan said, you can understand by becoming immersed in Bhakti Yoga. In your samadhi of devotion, you can see the pastimes of the Lord. Therefore, first, even Vyasadeva, he is the incarnation of God, but even these things were beyond him. Therefore, that lesson is given. First, one should completely surrender to the spiritual master. One should come in a mood, O Gurudev, I don't know anything at all. I am in complete ignorance. O Gurudev, please manifest yourself in my heart. First, one surrenders to the spiritual master, then all this knowledge will be possible. Therefore, Narada Muni dispelled the doubt of Vyasadeva by telling his own life history. Therefore, often we see in the scriptures, the spiritual master will talk about his own experience, and then after he may discuss something from the scriptures. The wonderful example of this is given in the Ramayana. In the Ramayana, when Meghna, the son of Ravan, was fighting with Ram and Lakshman, then he threw one type of weapon called Nagpas, like a snake rope. And that bound Ram and Lakshman, they fell unconscious. Therefore, Garuda went there, and when the snakes that were binding Ram and Lakshman saw Garuda, they became afraid and ran away. Therefore, Garuda, he is the personal carrier of Lord Narayan, but he became full of doubt. If I had to rescue Ram, then what type of Bhagawan is he? That means I am more powerful than him. Therefore, Garuda's mind became full of doubt. How can Ram be the Supreme Lord? Therefore, with his doubt, Garuda went to Shankar, Mahadev. Then Mahadev said, if you wanted to study your doubt, you should go and listen to the crow, Karaprasambhi. So this is a great, in one way, shameful thing, because Garuda is the king of birds, and he has to go and take shiksha from a crow. So you know crows are the lowest birds because they always eat garbage and low things. Therefore, in order to dispel the doubt of Garuda, then Karaprasambhi sought his own life. He said, listen, I also had a doubt about Lord Ram as Bhagawan. Because when I went to Ayodhya, that time Ram was very small, like a baby, crawling on his hands and knees, and he was eating some malpur. Malpur means what?
Pancake.
Like an Indian pancake, full of oil and sugar, very nice. Then Ram was eating this pancake, and he was showing the crow. Then he was eating. Then Karaprasambhi went to steal some of that malpur from Ram, and he stole it, and Ram began crying. Then Karaprasambhi, the crow, had even more doubts. Even he can't protect a piece of pancake, how will he protect me? Therefore, understanding his doubt, Lord Ram sucked him into his mouth, like that. And inside the body of Lord Ram, millions and millions and millions of universes. And Karaprasambhi was wandering one universe to the next universe for billions and billions and billions of years. Then finally, while he was in the stomach of Ram, he came there and he saw Ram again. Then Ram expelled it from his mouth, and then Karaprasambhi saw, I am in the same position, baby Ram has the piece of pancake in his hand, and Ram was smiling. Therefore Karaprasambhi said, by this, all my doubts that Ram was the Supreme Lord was dispelled. Therefore, Garuda, you should have no doubt that Ram is not an ordinary person, he is part of Brahma, the Supreme Absolute Truth. Therefore, before the Guru will often speak his own realizations, his own experience, and then he may speak something from scripture, then the disciple will have so much faith in the words of the spiritual master. Therefore, without the spiritual, the conclusion is, without Guru, without that type of spiritual master, one cannot gain any knowledge of the Supreme Lord at all.
Shyam Rani, will you speak the Narad Charitra?
Om Jnanam Timirandasya Jnananjana Salakaya Chaksuram Yulitam Yena Tasmai Sri Guruvena. Srila Gurudev has ordered me to speak about the life history of Sri Narad Muni, because as he explained, sometimes the spiritual master will give an example of his own life to explain how he advanced in Krishna consciousness. So Narada has been trying to encourage Śrīla Vyāsadeva by telling him that although you've done so many wonderful scriptural works, any scripture that does not describe the transcendental name, fame, form, and pastimes of the Lord is just like the pilgrimage of the crows. On the other hand, those activities, those literatures which describe the Lord's pastimes and qualities, they create a revolution in the dust-worn hearts of a misdirected civilization. So in order to encourage Sri Vyāsadeva to write Srimad Bhagavatam, he's now giving an example of his own life. He said in the previous millennium, that is, in the previous day of Brahma, I was born as the son of a maidservant, and she was engaged in the service of Brahmanas, and so I also engaged in their service. Just once, I took the remnants of their prasadam, and by that powerful substance, there are three most powerful substances in this world. That is the prasadam of the pure devotee, the dust of the lotus feet of the pure devotee, and the water that has washed his lotus feet. So Narada is saying that just once I tasted the remnants of their prasadam, and just by doing that, a taste for hearing about the transcendental glories of the Lord awoken in my heart. I developed an attraction for those sages. He called them Bhagavad Gautamas, and our Srila Prabhupada, in his translation, called them Bhakti Vedantas. He said these great sages, although impartial by nature, they showed me great mercy, seeing that I was very receptive to them. I was not naughty at all. My senses were controlled. I wasn't interested in sports or other childhood activities. So by taking their prasadam, I gradually developed a taste for hearing them describe the glories of the Lord, which they were constantly doing. By such regular hearing, my attention on the lotus feet of the Lord and desire to hear developed so much that it became unflinching, and I had no desire to do anything else. Those sages, when it came to the end of the rainy season, because the reason I was able to have so much of their association is that sages generally travel. They don't stay in one place very long, just like Srila Gurudev. But during the rainy season, these sages stayed in one place, and my mother, who was a simple maidservant, and I, under her guidance, served them. So then, after the rainy season and the autumn season finished, the sages left that place. But before leaving, they instructed me very carefully on the most confidential knowledge of the Vedas. As a result of that, I became aware that I was completely in ignorance by identifying with this body and mind as myself. And gradually, three things happened to me. I became situated in transcendental knowledge, and then all mystic powers, like becoming smaller than an atom, heavier than a universe, reaching out to another planet, and taking a fruit from another planet. I got so many mystic powers as an insignificant concomitant factor of that transcendental knowledge of the Lord, and finally, I attained pure devotional service. So, then I realized this, and you also should please be aware of this, that does not a thing therapeutically treated cure a disease that was caused by that same thing before it was treated. For example, if I take too much milk, I might get diarrhea. So that same milk, when it becomes curd, mixed with some other herbs or medicines, will cure that disease. So similarly, Srinara is explaining what he realized in his own life, that those activities which caused our bondage, that is material activities, which performed under the guidance of Guru, become spiritual, like eating prasadam instead of eating bhoga, watching a movie of Sri Gurudev instead of watching a materialistic movie. The same activity, therapeutically treated with devotion under the guidance of Sri Guru, cures the disease of bondage to birth and death and gives one liberation. Therefore, O sage, being fixed in vows, you can easily, because you're self-realized, be situated in trance and write about the glories of the Lord, which is the only remedial measure to free one from all miseries. So Vyasadeva became so much more curious. He said, please tell me, O sage, because you are just like the sun. The sun can travel so easily everywhere, all over the three worlds. And you're just like the air, because you can enter into the internal regions of everything and everyone. You know the heart of all living entities, just like the super soul. So I have faith in you. Please tell me, now I'm so interested, what did you do after you were initiated by the sages? And what happened after they left? And I'd like to know, how did you get that transcendental body that you have now, which is Sat-Chit Ananda body, just like that of the Lord? So Narada reviewed with more detail that I was the son of a maidservant who, because I was her only son, she bound me with the bondage of affection. And because she was poor, she was helpless to do anything for me, though she tried. So I was engaged in the service of those sages, and when they left, by the will of Providence, my mother, one evening, while milking the cow, she became bitten in the leg by a serpent and immediately died. So I took this as the mercy of the Lord to free me now so that I could pursue fully the path of self-realization. So because the sages had already left that place, I also left. I was just a young boy, 5 years old. And I traveled and traveled through towns and villages and gardens and forests, even dangerous forests, full of snakes and owls and jackals. Whenever I became hungry or thirsty, I would just drink some water from the river. And finally I arrived at one uninhabited forest. And I had a desire to worship the Lord in this very pure place in the mode of goodness. This, Gurudev explained, was a material desire, though very subtle, because he wanted to worship the Lord in a particular condition. So he began meditating on the Lord, and meditating and meditating as the sages, the four Kumaras, had taught him. Gradually, the Lord appeared to appeared in his heart in a very beautiful four-armed form of Lord Narayan. But then he was experiencing so much ecstasy, tears were flowing from his eyes, hairs were standing on end. He was feeling unbounded joy. Then what happened? Instantly the Lord disappeared. And then he tried again and again to get back that meditation, but he couldn't. So he began to weep bitterly. And then the Lord reappeared to him, not in his form, but just as an aerial voice. And he told him, I appear to you just once and for a moment, just to increase your eagerness for me. But because you're not fully pure, therefore you won't see me again in this life. In order that you may come to the point of seeing me perpetually, you should meditate on me, but also chant my glories everywhere, all over the world, for the benefit of all souls and for your own happiness and purification. So the Lord bowed down to him, Narada bowed down to him, was now somewhat satisfied, and with his transcendental vina, oh, he didn't get the vina yet. He was glorifying the Lord so much, and then gradually he became more and more purified. He was in Mokshit Kasaya, or in Bhava Bhakti tiny, tiny tainted with the subtle material desire. But then as he gradually made more and more advancement, free from envy, very humble, and out of compassion for the fallen conditioned souls, glorifying the Lord, he came gradually to leaving his body. But he didn't leave his body just as we leave our body. We leave our body like the cat carrying the rat, and the rat is full of trepidation. But he left his body like a cat carrying a kitten, feeling safe and secure. And when he left his body, it was just like the simultaneous appearance of lightning and illumination. That is, as soon as he left that body, he immediately attained his transcendental body of Satchit Ananda, completely free from all material touch. And then it became the time of devastation of the universe. After 4,300,000,000 years, at the end of the day of Brahma, all the material elements and all the entities merge into the body of Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, who's lying on the bottom of the universe. So Narada is explaining that I also entered, and then in the beginning of the next day of Brahma, so many millions of years, billions of years later, I came out as the son of Brahma. He doesn't come out as the son of anybody like we do, but just like the Lord is Yashoda Nandan, Nandanandan. Transcendentally, similarly, Narada appeared as the son of Brahma from the body of the Lord, actually. So he's telling Vyasadeva so that Vyasadeva will also have faith in his words. So he says that you are very qualified to glorify the Lord. So please enter into the trance of Bhakti Yoga, and thus you'll be able to write a literature that will free everyone of all miseries. So after Narada gave his beautiful encouragement to Srila Vyasadeva, he left that spot with his Veena. He said, now I'm able to travel all over the universes, all over the spiritual universes. He's even able to go to Goloka Vrindavan and even see the gopis and associate with Radharani and Lalita. He goes to Ayodhya and associates with Ram. So after he left, Srila Vyasadeva, with full faith, entered into a trance of Bhakti Yoga. Bhakti Yogena Manasi Samya Pranihite Male Apashat Purusham Purnam Mayam Pashritam Pashrayam. And then he saw all the Lord's pastimes by the mercy of Sri Narada. As Srila Gurudev said, even if you're the expansion of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, without Guru's mercy and surrendering to Guru, you can't realize anything or become free from matter. So by the mercy of Guru, he saw all the pastimes of Krishna from the beginning, when he killed Putana witch, when he appeared in the womb of Devaki, when he took birth from the womb of Yasoda, all the way to when he went to Mathura and Dwarka. He saw how Uddha came to Vrindavan and saw the glory of Srimati Radhika. He saw everything from beginning to end. And then he compiled that Srimad Bhagavatam. He saw that all living entities in his trance, he saw the Supreme Personality of Godhead in his mind completely free from all material taints. And he saw as a shadow far away in the background the material illusory energy of the Lord. He saw that all living entities are suffering unnecessarily, just from ignorantly identifying with this body. He saw how all these miseries, which are actually superfluous to the soul, can immediately be finished. All anarthas immediately be finished by the devotional service of the Lord. Anartham upasamam shakshai bhakti yoga hoksaje lokasya janataha vidvams chakrasakataha. And therefore he wrote that scripture in pure goodness, Srimad Bhagavatam. And now we're getting the mercy of Sri Guru, who's as powerful or more than Sri Narada, and Vyasadeva, who's giving us that transcendental knowledge.
Narada ji, Vyasadeva ko upadesh dekar, वहां से चले गए। तब व्यास जी अपने आश्रम में समाधि योग लगाया और उसमें अपश्यत पुरुषम पूर्ण पुरुष को देखा। माने क्या? कृष्ण को देखा। वहां के जितने परिकर नंद बाबा यशोदा मैया को देखा, सखाओं को देखा, गोपियों को देखा, रासस्थली देखा। रास में उनका जितना गोपियों के साथ में जैसे जैसे नृत्य किया था, सब लीलाओं को उन्होंने दर्शन किया। और दर्शन करने के बाद में ये भी देखा, जीव जो भगवान का नित्य दास है, भगवान का अणु है, स्थानीय है, वो भगवान को भूल करके यद्यपि माया से परे है, चिन्मय है, सच्चिदानंदमय है आंशिक रूप में, किंतु अपने को माया का वशीभूत समझकर, ये शरीर मैं हूं, ये हमारे कुटुंबी है, धन है हमारा, सब कुछ है, इस प्रकार से मोहित होकर संसार में भटक रहा है। और अनर्थोपशमम साक्षात भक्ति योगम अधोक खजे लोकस्य अजानतो विद्वान चक्रे समन्विता। और फिर समाधि में जो कुछ देखा था ठीक वैसे ही जो लोग ये तत्व नहीं जानते हैं उन लोगों को जनाने के लिए, बतलाने के लिए श्रीमद् भागवत की रचना की। रचना व्यास जी ने नहीं की, निर्माण नहीं किया, जैसा देखा था वैसे ही लिखा। ये लीला नित्य है, पहले नहीं थी अब हुई, ऐसा नहीं पहले से ही वो लीला है। उन्होंने देखा और उसको लिपिबद्ध किया, जैसा देखा था वैसा किया। जैसा वही सूर्य मायण कृष्ण परम पुरुषे भक्ति उपपद्यते पुंसव शोक मोह भया, जिसके सुनने से परम पुरुष जो श्री कृष्ण में, उनके प्रति चरणों में अहेतु की भक्ति अवश्य ही हो जाती है, निश्चित रूप में हो जाती है, उनका शोक मोह भय डर सब कुछ दूर हो जाता है, आत्मा प्रसन्न हो जाती है। और फिर रचना करके देखा, जे भाई अब किसको पढ़ाएं, जगत में योग्य कौन है जो इसको ग्रहण कर सके, जो संसार से पूर्ण रूप से निवृत्त है, जिसको अब संसार वासना कोई कामना नहीं है, और ऐसा योग्य जो हमारे बातों को समझ सके, उसको ये पढ़ाऊंगा। उस समय में व्यास जी ने सोचा कि जंगल में चले गए थे और कहां पुत्र हमारा है, खोज रहे थे। कुछ सुख पक्षी बजाने वाले बहेलिए जा रहे थे जंगल में सुख पकड़ने के लिए, पक्षी पकड़ने के लिए। तो काल पूछा, जे कहां जा रहे हो? तो जंगल में किस लिए? पक्षियों को पकड़ करके हम बेच देते हैं, जीविका निर्वाह। अच्छा, मैं तुमको एक मंत्र बतलाता हूं, उस मंत्र को करने से तुम्हारे जाल में बहुत से पक्षी आ जाएंगे। तब उन्होंने कहा, ये मंत्र जपना, बरहा पीड़म नट पर बपु कर्णयो कर्णिकार बृहद बासम कनक कपसम वैजयंती जमाला रंदन प्रेणुर अदल सुधया पूरे अनुगोप बिंदई बिंदारण्यम सपदर्पणम पाप। उन्होंने मुखस्त कर लिया और जंगल में जाकर के बोलने लगे, सचमुच में आज बहुत से पक्षी के साथ साथ में एक सुख पक्षी भी आ गया वहां, वही सुखदेव गोस्वामी। वो सुखदेव गोस्वामी ने पूछा, ये तुमने श्लोक कहां से सुना? तो हमने अपने गुरु जी हैं हमारे व्यास जी, उनसे सुना। तो उनसे पूछ करके कल आना, कि उनके गुण क्या है। फिर गए दूसरे दिन, फिर उन लोगों ने पूछा तो व्यास जी ने कहा, ओह बकीयम स्तन काल कूटम जिघन से अपायद अपसान ले गई गति तम धात उचितम। बीस मिला करके अपने स्तन में मारने के लिए गई और उसको धात्री उचित गति दे दी। ओ ऐसे भगवान को छोड़ करके किसका हम भजन करेंगे। पहले गए फिर इस लोग बोला और वो इतने आकृष्ट हुए आत्मा रामस्य मुनयो उरुक्रमे कुर्वंत है तुकिं भक्तिं इत्थं भूतगुण है। ये तो ब्रह्म निष्ठा संपन्न थे, संसार से और भगवान से भी इनसे कोई संबंध कृष्ण से कृष्ण लीलाओं से नहीं था है? वो निर्विशेष परब्रह्म में इनकी बड़ी निष्ठा थी। किंतु भगवान के गुण ही ऐसे हैं, व्यास जी ने जो वर्णन किया वो रह नहीं सके, झट उनके पास में आ गए। आप कृपा करके जहां जो ग्रंथ की रचना की है हमको पढ़ाइए। तब उनको सुखदेव गोस्वामी जी को उन्होंने पढ़ाया। तब सुखदेव गोस्वामी ने सारे विश्व में प्रचार करने के लिए इस भागवत कथा को सबसे पहले मुमुर्षु परीक्षित महाराज जी को सुनाया। इसके बाद में गोकर्ण ने सुनाया
को,
और इसके थोड़े वर्षों के बाद में सनक सनंदन सनत कुमार जी ने नारद के बहाने भक्ति देवी को सुनाया, जिससे कि उनके पुत्र ज्ञान वैराग्य भी नौजवान हो गए और भक्ति भी बड़ी प्रसन्न हो गई। हाँ ट्रांसलेशन
Therefore, hearing all the instructions of Sri Narada Muni, then Sri Vyasa returned to his ashram. And there he engaged his mind according to the instructions of Sri Narada Muni. Bhakti yoga na manasi samyak pranati amali apasya purusam purnam manasatat apasya yoyosam amitam jivam atmanam tri manatmakam sarati manat anatam chakritam chabibhavyate. What did Vyasadeva see? He saw two things. First, he saw the Purna Purush, because God is a person. We are also persons, but God is the complete person. Then he saw that complete supreme person with his energy, that means Srimati Radhika, along with his associates, like the Gopis, Nanda Baba, Yasoda, along with the activities of that supreme Lord, like Ras Lila, and all the other Lilas, Vyasadeva saw in his trance of devotional yoga, bhakti yoga. And what else did he see? He saw that the individual soul, us, which is also a part of the Supreme Lord, a minute part, which is also transcendental, which is also composed of eternity, knowledge and bliss, but because of turning his face away from the Lord toward material enjoyment, he is captured by illusion and rotating in the cycle of birth, death, old age and disease. But he saw that if the jivas, the individual souls, turn their face again towards the service of the Lord, they can become liberated and eternally happy. Therefore, that in order that souls who have turned their face away from Krishna and who come to this world, in order that such souls, like us, can turn again towards the service of Krishna, Vyasadeva, out of his unlimited mercy, compiled the Srimad Bhagavatam, Anatma Pasanam Sakshat Bhakti Yoga Dasaji. By hearing this same Bhagavatam that Gurudev is speaking, this is the same Bhagavatam compiled by Vyasadeva. By hearing Anatma Pasanam Sakshat, all other bad desires are destroyed, and one is again taste the nectar of the service of the Supreme Lord. Therefore, how important is hearing? Don't think that Vyasadeva made this up or compiled. No, don't think that at all. What Vyasadeva saw in his meditation, he wrote only that. Because the pastimes of the incarnations of the Supreme Lord are all eternal. They have no beginning and no end. Therefore, yasya vai sriyamanayam. Whoever hears this Srimad Bhagavatam then merely devotional service to Krishna awakens within the heart. Therefore, Vyasadeva had many disciples, but he thought, this Bhagavatam is so pure and spotless, to whom will I give this thing? Therefore, he remembered. Remember the first day Gurudev came, he spoke about the history of Sukadev Goswami. So Gurudev tying all this together. He remembered, I have that one son, Sukadev Goswami. He is completely detached from material enjoyment. Therefore, I will give this Bhagavatam to him and to him only. Therefore, as Vyasadeva was moving, he saw one hunter, one bird catcher. And Vyasadeva asked him, where are you going? He said, I'm going to catch birds. And I'll sell them in the market, like parrots, things like that. Then Vyasadeva said, I'll give you a special mantra. This mantra is so attractive, many birds will come in your net. So the hunter said, very good. Then Vyasadeva taught him one of these verses from the Bhagavatam, which is mantra. Bharavitam tatamarabhapu kaneo kanikaram vipratasa kanamikapisam vajayantin chamaram, etc. Describing the beautiful form of Krishna. Then as the hunter was chanting that mantra, many, many birds came, and also one big bird, that is Sukadev Goswami, now in human form. We heard that on the first day. He came and caught hold of that hunter. Such a nectarian mantra. Who is that person who has such a beautiful form? Then Sukadev Goswami said, where did you get this mantra from? I never heard such nectar. Then the hunter said, I got it from my Gurudev, Vyas. He said, Sukadev Goswami said, you go back to your Gurudev and ask. That person who you're describing has such a wonderful form. But what are his qualities? Sometimes we see someone who's very beautiful, but they may be very cruel or selfish, therefore not so perfect. They will tell me, what are the qualities of that person whom you're describing? Then the hunter went back to Vyasadeva and told them. Vyasadeva said, I'll give you another verse. Oh, Bhakiyam Stanakala Kutam, Yamasi Apiyasabi. Levitatam Yasta Utapato Anyam. Kovai Saranam.
Kangadayanu
Saranam Brajema. Who is more kind than Krishna? When Krishna was a little baby, 7 years old, 7 days old, one witch came to poison him by putting poison on her breast to kill him. But Krishna is so merciful. He took the poison, took her life, and sent her, gave her a position in the spiritual world. Therefore, who is more merciful than Krishna? He liberates those who even come to kill him, or to speak of those who are chanting his name with love. Therefore, such wonderful qualities. Therefore, Sukadev Goswami became mad, intoxicated, and he went to Vyasadeva and fell at his feet. Please tell me about Krishna and the worship of Krishna. Then there's a famous verse in the Bhagavatam, Atmanam Shimuneo Nigrantiti Urukrami Kuravanti Uvipikim Bhaktim Itam Bhoto Manohari. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave 64 explanations of these verses. What does it mean? That Krishna is so attractive, Itam Bhoto Manohari. He has such wonderful qualities like beauty, compassion, pastimes, that he attracts the minds of even liberated souls. Therefore, this is proof. Sukadeva Goswami was Brahmanista. He was completely absorbed in Nirvishesh Brahm, like the big white light that everybody talks about. He was completely absorbed in that, he had no material attachment. When he heard about the form of Krishna, the qualities of Krishna, the activities of Krishna, he gave that up and became a devotee of Krishna. There were the same Vyasadeva, the same Srimad Bhagavatam, that Narada Muni gave to Vyas. And Vyas gave to Sukadeva Goswami. Then 5,000 years ago, again it was spoken to Parikshit Maharaj. And this same we are getting a chance to hear from Gurudev. That same Bhagavatam was also spoken in the Padma Purana, we see Bhagavat Mahatmya. This same Bhagavat was spoken by the Chatusna, the four Kumaras, to Narada. And also,
as excuse of Narada, he taught to Devian Ganvira.
Also, Dandik, what's his name? Dundakari, too. Dundakari, to Dundakari, the same Bhagavatam. Therefore, this is an unbroken chain of Srimad Bhagavatam descending from that time even to this present day. Srimad Bhagavat ki.
श्रीमद् भागवत के अंत में व्यास जी ने स्वयं ही लिखा है, श्रीमद् भागवतम पुराण अमलम जत वैष्णवानाम प्रियम। श्रीमद् भागवत वैष्णवों का प्रिय ग्रंथ है और द्वैतवादियों का, मायावादियों का नहीं है, किंतु आजकल गीता प्रेस से जो भागवत निकलती है उसका जो अर्थ है उसके करने वाले अखंडानंद सरस्वती महामायावादी और अद्वैतवादी थे। उन्होंने इसका उल्टा अर्थ करके जो नहीं होना चाहिए वो सब अर्थ करके उन्होंने कहा कि भागवत का तात्पर्य है ब्रह्म में साइज मुक्ति। वैष्णव लोग तो दीयमानों की न गृहणती बिना मत सेवन जना। वैष्णव लोग तो भगवान कहते हैं कि हमारी मुक्ति ले लो पांच प्रकार की और वो कहते हैं कि नहीं 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 नहीं, आंख बंद करके घृणा लगती है नहीं लेते हैं। किंतु अखंडानंद सरस्वती इत्यादि अद्वैतवादियों ने गीता प्रेस की ये पुस्तक के द्वारा सारे विश्व में मायावाद का प्रचार किया किंतु यह बात ठीक नहीं है। आप लोग समझ रखिए गीता का भागवत का तात्पर्य भक्ति से है, कभी भी साई मुक्ति या किसी भी मुक्ति नहीं है, उसका खंडन किया है। श्रेयासिक्तिम भक्ति मुदस्य ते विभो तीस्यंत जे का वो तो भूसी के कूटने के समय चावल का कण पाने के लिए यदि भूसी को थोथी भूसी को यदि लाख वर्ष तक कूटिए कुछ नहीं मिलेगा, ऐसे व्यर्थ परिश्रम है। इसलिए आप लोग समझ रखिए जो भागवत का तात्पर्य भक्ति है, मैं ब्रह्म नहीं हूं ब्रह्म का सेवक हूं ये समझिए। कृष्ण कृष्ण की लीला कृष्ण का नाम गुण लीला ये सब अप्राकृत और नित्य है, भगवान की सेवा नित्य है। इसलिए वैष्णव का ग्रंथ है, इसमें पढ़ने से भगवान की सेवा होगी भक्ति होगी। जस्या वही श्रूयमाणायाम कृष्ण परम पुरुषे भक्ति रूप पद्धति है कौन सा शोक मोह भया, यह ऐसी भक्ति होती है। यह भक्ति भी अच्छा ट्रांसलेशन करो
And yet Vaishnavanam Priyam is very dear to the Vaishnavas, the devotees of Krishna. Therefore, but an astonishing thing is that nowadays, okay, in India there's a very cheap publishing company called Gita Press. And they're one good thing, they print books very cheaply, but their bad thing is they give completely wrong explanations of most of it. Therefore, the Srimad Bhagavatam has been, one commentary has been written there by one Akananda Saraswati. And there he has said the goal of the Bhagavatam is to merge with God, merge with Krishna. This is called Sayuja Mukti. But this is completely ridiculous because Sukadeva Goswami, he already gave up Sayuja Mukti to become a devotee and then he's going to go back to it. Therefore, even if these five types of liberation are given to the devotees, Dhyamanam, Madhyanam, Dhinamam, Sevanam, Janam, even if the Lord himself offers five types of liberation, including Sayuja Mukti, Brahmanin, the devotee hates it. Grina means they close their eyes and don't even look towards it. Therefore, Sayuja Mukti or merging with God has been completely rejected in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Therefore, these people are giving the wrong explanation of the Bhagavatam. Therefore, the conclusion in the beginning, the middle, and the end of the Bhagavatam, there is only one thing, service to God, service to Krishna, or Bhakti Yoga. We see so many times in the Bhagavatam that the idea of merging with Krishna is completely rejectable. Because if you merge with Krishna, you cannot do his service. Therefore, Lord Brahma has said, that person who gives up the process of bhakti or any other process is like a person who pounds rice bran, the husk of rice to get some grains. It means hard work with no benefit at all. Therefore, we are not God, we are not Brahma. What are we? We are servants of God, servants of Prabhupada. Therefore, Krishna's name, form, qualities, and activities are all eternal. And Srimad Bhagavatam has described only that, service to Sri Krishna. There is no other conclusion.
Bhakti ke tatamya se भक्त भी पांच प्रकार के होते हैं। जिसके हृदय में जैसी जहां तक भक्ति है उसी के अनुसार में वो भक्त है। भक्त एक ही प्रकार का नहीं होता, उनकी कैटेगरी लाखों की है, किंतु उनमें से सबको छांट कर पांच प्रकार के माना है। पहला है ज्ञानी भक्त, दूसरा है शुद्ध भक्त, तीसरा प्रेमी भक्त, चौथा प्रेम पर भक्त, और पांचवा है प्रेमातुर। अब इसको समझिए, पहला है ज्ञानी भक्त। ज्ञान में और ज्ञानी भक्त में बहुत अंतर है। ज्ञानी है वह जो अपने को ब्रह्म मानता है और उसमें सहज मुक्ति चाहता है, वो ज्ञानी है। और ज्ञानी भक्त भगवान के समस्त तत्व को जानकर, कृष्ण तत्व, जीव तत्व, माया तत्व और कृष्ण राधा तत्व, रस तत्व, ये सब तत्वों को जो जान करके और भक्ति करता है वो ज्ञानी भक्त है। जैसे प्रह्लाद महाराज, जैसे प्रथम जीवन में सुखदेव गोस्वामी, द्वितीय जीवन में, पहले वो भी निर्विशेषवादी, अद्वैतवादी नहीं, निर्विशेषवादी नहीं, ब्रह्मवादी थे। ब्रह्मवाद में और अद्वैत गायन में बहुत अंतर है। तो वो ब्रह्म ज्ञान निष्ठ थे, ब्रह्मनिष्ठ, और ना और कौन, सनक सनंदन सनातन, ये लोग भी ब्रह्मनिष्ठ थे। ब्रह्मा की कृपा से नारायण लोक में जाकर के नारायण के चरणों में दी हुई तुलसी का मकरंद उनके कान नाकों में गया और तब वो भी बिक गए भगवान के चरणों में। इसलिए भक्ति ही सर्वश्रेष्ठ है। तो मैं क्या कह रहा था,
ज्ञानी भक्त
वह है जो भगवान के तत्व को जानने वाला है और अपने इष्ट देव को, प्रभु को सर्वव्यापी समझकर सब जीवों के हृदय में देखता है और जीवों के हृदय में भगवान को देखता है। अपने और सब जीवों के हृदय में भगवान को देखता है, अपने इष्ट देव को, और इष्ट देव में सबको देखता है। ये महाभागवत प्रह्लाद महाराज जी जैसे ज्ञानी भक्त हैं। कैसे हैं, संक्षेप में हम लोग थोड़ा सा वर्णन करेंगे। मैं तो कृष्ण का की लीलाओं को वर्णन करना चाहता था, किंतु यह जानना आवश्यक है, नहीं तो भक्ति नहीं होगी, इसलिए इनके चरित्रों को भी कहना अत्यंत आवश्यक है। इसलिए हमारे पद्मनाभ महाराज जी संक्षेप में उनका बाल चरित्र प्रह्लाद महाराज जी का बतलाइए।
So Buddha says that he has a great desire to speak the pastimes of Krishna, but unless we understand some things first, then we will not understand the activities of Krishna. So even though they are great, all types of devotees are not the same, and their absorption is also not the same. There are millions and millions of different levels of devotees and devotion. But in a very simplified form, we can say there are five types of devotees. Jnani Bhakta, Sudha Bhakta, Premi Bhakta, Prema Par Bhakta, and Prem Atur Prema Atur. First, what is Jnani Bhakta? We should understand there is a great difference between a Jnani and a Jnani Bhakta. A Jnani are those who accept themselves as Brahma, as spiritual essence, and their goal is to become one with God. They are called Jnanis. But quite different from them are the Jnani Bhaktas. The Jnani Bhaktas, they know Krishna, and they know everything related to Krishna. His names, forms, qualities, pastimes, his energies, his different modes, they know everything. And knowing everything, they engage themselves in the service of the Lord. They are called Jnani Bhaktas. Therefore, there's two completely different things, Jnani and Jnani Bhakta. What's an example of a Jnani Bhakta? A Jnani Bhakta is like Prahlad Maharaj, or like Sri Sukadeva Goswami in his second stage. At first, Sri Sukadeva Goswami was a Brahmavadi, but he was not an Advaitavadi. Brahmavadi and Advaitavadi is a very, very different thing. We could have explained after. Brahmavadi means they have mystery in Brahma. They accept Bhagavan's form, but they are more attracted to the impersonal aspect. But in Advaitavadi, they do not accept the form of Bhagavan. Therefore, there is a huge difference between a Brahmavadi and Advaitavadi. Brahmavadis, like Sukadeva Goswami, if they get association with the devotee, they can easily become devotees. There was Sukadeva Goswami in his second stage. He knows all tattva, everything about Krishna and engages in his service. Also, like the mental born sons of Lord Brahma, they are called the four Kumara, or the Chakusna. Before, they were also Brahmavadis. But their father and guru, Lord Brahma, by his inspiration, they went to the spiritual world, Vaikuntha. And as they went, Lord Narayan, say Krishna to make it easy, Lord Krishna came outside. That time they smelt the tulsi leaves mixed with sandalwood on the feet of Krishna. And that smell went in their nose, they changed and became attracted to devotion. Therefore, they are also known as Jnani Bhaktas. What is their symptom? They see that worshipful Lord everywhere and everything in Him. Means in Him they see all jivas. In the hearts of all jivas they see only Him. And in His heart they see everything. Everything is in Him and He is in everything. They're everywhere they look and everything they see nothing else except the Supreme Lord. Such a person is called a Jnani Bhakta. Therefore, an example of Jnani Bhakta is Prahlad Maharaj. And now Pujapad Padmanabharaj will describe something, the childhood pastimes of the childhood teachings of Prahlad Maharaj.
Om Jnana Trinandasya Jnanam Jana Shalakaya Chakshurum Meditam Jena Tasmai Sri Gurade Namaha. So, Srila Gurudev is teaching us the different levels of bhaktas, which are indicated in the Srimad Bhagavatam, specifically five levels of bhaktas. So he has ordered me to tell in very brief the charitra, the character and history of Sri Prahlad Maharaj from the seventh canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So we have heard from Srimad Bhagavatam that Prahlad Maharaj, he was the son of a very great demon. This demon was named Hiranyakashipu. So Hiranyakashipu, he wanted to get revenge against Vishnu, Lord Vishnu. Because in another place in Srimad Bhagavatam it describes that Lord Vishnu had come in the form of Lord Varahadev and had killed his brother named Hiranyaksha. So Hiranyakashipu was also a very great materialistic person, so he went and did very severe austerities. And these severe austerities are vividly described in Srimad Bhagavatam, that he stood on the tips of his toes. And for thousands of years, he was performing this very hard austerity. Even the ants had eaten his bodily flesh and muscle. Only his skeleton and bones were remaining. And anthills were built all around him. So when he had completed his austerities, then Lord Brahma came. Lord Brahma, the creator of this universe, he is not the Supreme Lord. He is a demigod who is empowered by the Supreme Lord to create this universe. But that was the aim and object of Hiranyakashipu, that Lord Brahma would award him any of his desires. he would fulfill any of his desires as a reward for his severe austerity. So, when Lord Brahma came and he saw what kind of austerity he had done, only his skeleton was remaining, and he was so powerful that even he could keep his life airs, his prana, within the bones of his body. So now Lord Brahma came there on his swan carrier. And from his kamandalu, he poured some droplets of nectar on the head of Hiranyakashipu. Now, immediately, Hiranyakashipu was restored to a very powerful body, like a thunderbolt, very young, beautiful, and powerful. And immediately, Hiranyakashipu saw Lord Brahma, and he paid his obeisances to him. So Lord Brahma now inquired from him, what kind of benediction would you like? And Hiranyakashipu, he told the Lord Brahma, I want to become immortal, that I will never have to die. So then Lord Brahma told him, he said, actually, I cannot give you that benediction because even I myself must die. So how can I give you the benediction of immortality? So then Hiranyakashipu, he thought of some other benedictions. He said, okay, then at least award me that I will not die in the day or in the night time. And the Lord Brahma said, okay, I can give you that benediction. You will not die in the day or the night. And he said, give me the benediction that I will not die on the land, on the water, or in the air. Yes, I can give you that benediction. Give me the benediction that I will not die by any being created by you within this universe, man or animal or beast or anything. Yes, I can give you that benediction. Give me the benediction that I cannot be killed by any weapon, any type of weapon, man-made weapon. Yes, I can give you that benediction. And in this way, Hiranyakashipu received the sanction that he would not die in any of these ways. And then he calculated, oh, okay, now I have become immortal. And he raised his arms and loudly declared his immortality. So it so happened that during the same time, the queen of Hiranyakashipu, because the demigods were realizing that this demon will become very powerful, and in the womb of the wife of Hiranyakashipu was a baby. So they thought, this baby, this child of Hiranyakashipu, will become a great demon just like him. Better that we kidnap her, and that we should kill the baby in the womb before he disturbs the whole universe. So then as they were carrying away the wife of Hiranyakashipu, Narada Muni came. And Narada Muni stopped the demigods, and he told them, no, no, you don't understand, in the womb of this woman, there is a very great devotee, actually. So then he took that lady to his ashram, and there, Sri Naradaji, he began to speak the glories of Sri Krishna, just like we have heard today, how he instructed Srila Vyasadeva. So Narada Muni himself spoke all these transcendental glories of Srimad Bhagavatam and so forth, all the pastimes of Krishna. So in the womb, the child was hearing. So when the child was born, oh, that child was actually a pure devotee named Prahlad Maharaj. So Hiranyakashipu, after receiving this power, he began to terrorize the whole universe. And he was so powerful that even he was able to defeat all the demigods, including Lord Indra. And he took over even the throne of the King of Heaven, Lord Indra, and he sat on that throne. And from that position, he was so powerful, he was even controlling the movements of the sun and the time factor. And even karma, it is described, he was controlling the karma of the living entities. So in this way, Hiranyakashipu, although very, very demoniac, he now thought that he was immortal and all-powerful. So, in Srimad Bhagavatam, it describes that when Prahlad Maharaj was a young boy, very small, like 5 years old, that his father sent him to school with the other royal young children. And when his son came back from school on the first day, then he came to the lap of his father. And his father became overwhelmed with affection to see his young, beautiful child all decorated nicely by his mother. And now he lifted his child onto his lap, and he began to smell the head of his child with affection, and he looked at his child's face and he said, "Oh my dear son, please, no, please tell me, what do you think is the very best thing that you have learned from your teachers?" And then Prahlad Maharaj, he looked at his father and he said, "Oh," he didn't call him "my dear father," he said, "Oh, best of the demons, best of the asuras, tatsadaman ye asuravaryam dehinam, sadasabud vignabhya asabdrahat, hitvat mapatam grihamanda kupam, gato haram yad haramashrayeta." So, Prahlad Maharaj gave a very powerful instruction to his father. He said, "Oh my dear father, you ask me what is the best thing. I think that the very best thing is that those persons who have constantly been absorbed in this deep dark well of household life in this material world, they have accepted this temporary situation of life as being eternal and permanent. And therefore, they're constantly filled with all kinds of anxieties. They have fallen into this very andakubam, this dark well of material existence. So I think the best thing is that they should immediately give this up. Hitvatmapatam griham andakubam. They should give up this dark well immediately. And manangato yat parim ashrayita, they should go to the forest and take full shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari." Oh, when Hiranyakashipu heard this, oh, he was completely startled that his son would come out with such a thing, glorifying his enemy, Hari, Lord Vishnu. But actually, Prahlad Maharaj, he was giving a very important teaching, because the purport of what Prahlad Maharaj told, there's a very nice description to give us a clear understanding of what he was teaching, what he was trying to tell to his father. And the story goes that once there was a person who was walking through a forest. So, as he was walking through this forest, suddenly he heard a very loud sound. And he turned and he looked, and he saw there was a tiger with gaping jaws staring right at him. So what did he do? Immediately, he began to run as fast as he possibly could, and he was running, and now the tiger began to run after him also. And he ran and ran. And everywhere he was looking, where can I get away from this tiger? Where can I find shelter? Suddenly, he looked and he saw that there was a well that was somewhat covered with some grasses. So, and there was a tree hanging over the well that a couple of branches were hanging down. So he grabbed a hold of those two branches of the tree with his two arms, and he lowered himself down into the well. And now when he was hanging there, holding onto the branches, he looked upwards and he saw the tiger's mouth again looking down at him, growling. And then he looked below him, and then he saw that there were snakes hissing, and they were trying to also bite him from below. And now he realized, "Oh my God, what will I do now?" So, then, to make things even a little bit worse, it couldn't get much worse than this, but it does. So he's holding on to these two branches, and he looks up and he sees that on each branch, there's two rats, and they're chewing on the branch. One rat is white, one rat is black. So he's now lost all hope practically at all, but still he's holding on for dear life. And then he notices one thing. Just up above him, there's a beehive. And this beehive has some honey that's dripping down out of it. And the dripping of that honey is falling just in front of his face, a couple of inches forward in front of his face. So what does he do? He thinks, "Oh, very good." He stretches out, he tries to lean his head forward, and he puts out his tongue as far as he can, and he catches a couple of drops of honey on his tongue. And then he thinks, "Oh, how sweet." But did the tiger disappear? No. Did the snakes disappear? No. Did the rats stop biting? No. So what is the purport of this story? Who is this person running through the forest? Can anyone tell me? Who is that person? It's you and me. Every one of us in this material world are exactly like this man. Why? Because who is the tiger? Now, the tiger is impending death. Is there anyone in this room who is not facing impending death? You can raise your hand if there is someone here. Huh? No courage, huh? And so, impending death is definitely there for every single person who has been born. And Krishna, Lord Sri Krishna says in Gita, if the one who is born, death is certain. So therefore, and below us, while we're going through this life, facing death at any single moment, we don't know when, below us there are these snakes. What are the snakes representing? The snakes are representing all the miseries of material existence constantly biting you and old age creeping up on you at any moment. And above, oh, you're holding on to these branches. What is the branches? Your duration of life. No one knows how long. Could be 10 years, could be 50, could be 90. But no one knows. No one guaranteed how long. So then he's holding on to the branches. But we see that the branches are also gradually, bit by bit, being eaten away by two rats. What are those two rats? One is white, one is black. That represents the day and the night. Every day, every night, every day, every night, your duration of life is going away, never to return. But yet, in that condition of life, what are we doing, just like this man, who is in such a horrifying condition of life? He sees a little bit of honey, and he thinks, oh, let me taste that honey. And he forgets for that moment. By tasting a few drops of honey, a little bit of sweetness, he forgets his horrifying condition of life. And he thinks, oh, how nice, how sweet. What is that honey? That honey is all the affection that we're getting from our loved ones, from our family members, our husband, wife, children. And we forget, thinking that this danger will not come upon us, that death will not come. And we put all our hopes, all of our trust in the protection of these loved ones. So like this, Prahlad Maharaj instructed his father, Hiranyakashipu, that a person who is really, really intelligent, he should give up this ignorant state of life where one is blinded by materialistic desires. And he should take shelter of Lord Hari. That means he should perform the process of pure Shuddha Bhakti. So when Hiranyakashipu heard this from his son, he became very upset. But he told to his teachers, he said, oh, just see how the enemy sometimes tries to infiltrate and tries to contaminate the minds of the young ones. Oh, now you should take him to school and you should guard him much more carefully, much more carefully. So the two teachers took him away to school. The two teachers' names were Shanda and Amarika. And these two teachers now, they try to teach Prahlad Maharaj all sociology and politics and all the normal topics that a son in a royal demonic family should learn. How to rule, how to govern, how to defeat enemies, etc. So after some time, again, one day, the teachers, Prahlad Maharaj's mother, bought...
Thank you. यहीं तक हरि कथा का विश्राम हम लोग देते हैं. कल प्रहलाद महाराज जी का चरित्र और उसके बाद में जैसा जैसा हमने भक्ति का स्तर बतलाया है उसी तरह से हम लोग वर्णन करेंगे. कुछ लोग यदि श्रीमद् भागवत को सप्ताह सुनते हैं, यदि कोई व्यक्ति एक श्लोक भी रोज पाठ करे तो वो जन्म मरण से मुक्त हो जाएगा. यदि कोई व्यक्ति आधा श्लोक भी, उसका आधा एक पाद भी यदि करे तो भी उसको भक्ति होगी. किंतु 7 दिन में भागवत की कथा का प्राचलन चला हुआ है, इससे श्रेष्ठ 1 महीने वाला है, 1 महीने में जो भागवत का पाठ किया जाता है. और उससे श्रेष्ठ है एक वर्ष में, और उससे भी श्रेष्ठ है जो हम लोग कह रहे हैं ये जीवन भर में समाप्त नहीं होगा, ये सब समय चलता रहेगा। इसलिए हम लोग तत्व को उभाड़ कर एक एक करके बतलाते हैं, जिससे कि उनके हृदय में जल्दी से भक्ति प्रतिष्ठित हो जाए। इसलिए हमारी भागवत की कथा अभी शेष नहीं होगी, दो दिन के बाद में यहाँ प्रवचन समाप्त हो जाने के बाद में फिर जब हम आएंगे इसके बाद से फिर हम आरंभ करेंगे।
फिजी शुरू होगा, फिजी के बाद ऑस्ट्रेलिया शुरू होगा।
इस तरह से हरि कथा चलते रहेगी। गौर प्रेमानंदे महामंत्र हरे कृष्ण।
Translation. Real Bhagavatam is taught in 7 days. But superior to that is 30 days continuous hearing. And superior to that is a 1 year continuous hearing of Bhagavatam. The Guru said the Bhagavatam we do is better than all of them because ours is continuous, it never stops. Therefore, if one can hear Bhagavatam continuously from the proper person, then bhakti will definitely enter the heart. So even though we're finishing our Harikatha today, After this program, as Srila Gurudev leaves to go out, after this there will be aarti and very wonderful Mahaprasadam feast for all, so everyone should stay and take Mahaprasadam. Gaur Premanande, Srila Gurudev ki jai, Granthana Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Saveda Bhakta Vrinda ki jai, Nitai Gaur Premanande. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Krishna.